I'm going to go without the mic. Is everyone okay there? Thank you for that beautiful introduction. So my talk is on how love transforms us. And being here today, I'm grateful to be here today. Thank you, Sarah Siegel, for founding this. Just by being in the room today, everybody's making a decision consciously or subconsciously that we're interested in something that is operating our lives beyond our conscious decisions. Who we choose to love, how we choose to be instigated by life, afraid, surrender to, excited by, right? And when I think about pure clarity and what this event is really, is it's what are we ingesting into our bodies, right? What are we ingesting into our minds? What are we reading, listening to, paying attention to? And then in terms of my talk, what are the relationships that we're bringing into our life, and particularly our significant other? The greatest indicator of joy and fulfillment in each one of our lives will be the significant other that we choose at any part of our life and how we engage with all the people that we bring into our life, but particularly our significant other. If we give that relationship lethargy and, you know, we feel expectant in that relationship, then that's what we're going to get, lethargy from it. Whereas if we give it our all, right, it's going to be challenging, but that's what we're going to get also from our life. So pertinent to this trailer, this movie I wrote, produced, and directed with a number of brilliantly talented individuals, I did a 10-year study on love, on this very thing that I'm speaking about. And I did it in two films. One was a movie called Awakening World, which is a documentary that explores five questions. What's the purpose of life? What's love? What's heaven? What's hell? And what's intimacy? And what I found out, what I discovered in that five-year journey on that, making that film, was that it had a lot to do with surrender. Then I also did a 10-year study on love at the same time with this film, with Grace and Grit, which is adapted from a book by Ken Wilburn, a true story about love beyond life. And I also discovered during that period that love had a lot to do with surrender. So when I started out in this study on love, I read Plato's Symposium, and Aristophanes writes in that and says in that, that men and women were once whole, but were torn in two. And the pursuit and desire of that whole is called love. Now, that's largely comedic, but there's a lot to be said about that. That there's these two separate entities, and that then together they become whole. So there's already a clue there, a story about what love is, that it's about something about becoming. So in my 10-year study, in the making of these two films, I explored a lot about surrender. And so when I think about that, we think about what is it? Because everybody sort of knows that on some intuitive level, right? We think about surrender. We think about surrender to, what is it? To your heart, right? And you think, okay, well, I get that, but what is that really? Who here has read The Alchemist, right, by Paulo Coelho? Okay, almost everybody in the room. So Paulo Coelho talks about that, that it's your personal legend, right? Listening to your heart. And that if you listen to it, it continues to speak to you. But if you don't listen to it, eventually it will stop speaking to you. So whether it's listening to your heart, your personal legend, we'll call it intuition, right? So what is intuition, right, on another level? So as the human body grows hair universally, the human mind grows ideas, and the human soul grows intuitions. Another way that I like to analogously explore what intuition is I think about fate and destiny. Right? And fate is when we're born into the world, what are we limited by? What are the parameters and the factors that we're limited by? Whereas destiny is, what are we capable of? How are we able to overcome some of those limitations to become more? So in destiny, I think about what is that destiny, right? Because we have this idea that it's this fixed point, but it's not actually a fixed point, right? It's like the personal legend, right? In The Alchemist, it's always reaching for us as long as we reach for it. So it's this hand, essentially, that's reaching down. And as long as you're reaching it, in other words, listening to your heart and following your intuition, it will always guide you and always change your course. But the moment you stop reaching, it stops reaching also. And you know that experience, right? When you're reaching for that, when you're trusting this courage, right, in your heart. Carl Jung talks about it when he says, what is the world asking of you, right? What is it asking of us? What is the world asking to be born through each one of us, right? You think about the billions of people who have ever lived, and not one has the same fingerprint. That the world is asking something unique from every single person here, from every single person that's ever lived, unique to anyone else. And so listening to that personal legend, listening to your heart, listening to your intuition is very much following that. So when we talk about love and how it transforms us, there's a story here really about becoming, right? That it's not about happiness, that it's about becoming. And whether you like it or not, that's what's happening. And we can look at that on a very scientific level from the Big Bang. Though you look at right after the Big Bang, let's say this Big Bang at least, that in infinite space, there's protons and neutrons and electrons floating around infinite space. And yet somehow they find a way to come together, right? That's a miracle. And they form atoms. So just like Aristophanes talks about in Plato's piece, that you have these separate entities coming together to become more, to become. Then now you have all these atoms still floating around, and they come together, right, to form molecules. And these molecules come together to form cells, and it progresses then into more complex life and sentient life. So there is a story since the beginning of time, since the beginning of the universe, about becoming, right? And this is this passage of love. And we would describe, right, in Greek, Eros as that form of attraction, as this form of magnetic attraction between us to become more. Okay, so then it poses the question, how do we know intuition? How do we know when we're listening to our heart, when we're following our personal legend, right? Because sometimes it gets confusing. Well, in my study, in my 10-year study on love, it ends up that there are markers that I discovered that, and that one of the markers is commitment versus impulsivity. That the more committed we are to something, the greater things unfold in our life. And everything that you've ever done and experienced, commitment is a part of all the joy that you've ever experienced. Whereas impulsivity, on the other end, on some level, is a part of everything that you've ever experienced that was horrible, right? So commitment, enrichment, and fulfillment, and depth, and becoming, and impulsivity, destruction. Not to say that it might not feel good sometimes, right? But impulsivity versus commitment. So there are markers of increasing commitment and decreasing impulsivity. I'm going to come back to that in a second. So in this 10-year study on love, I discovered 5 stages of love. And when I'm talking about love now, I'm particularly talking about with a significant other. And those 5 stages are romantic, passionate, courageous, selfless, and then transcendent. And I want to break those down a little bit. So romantic love is really an ideal, right? It's a dream. It's a projection. Like you're alone and you're a kid and you're growing up and you think about what is romantic love? And maybe it's from a fairy tale. And it's that idea that you're going to live a certain way with a certain person and how they are. And then maybe as an adolescent, you fall in love, but it's only romantically. It's not true or not true or right or wrong. It's just that's the depth of capacity that as an adolescent or as a child that you have for love. It's romantic love. It's all a projection. And then you find out that this individual that you're in love with is not that individual that you built in your romantic dream, right? And that's romantic love. And it's beautiful, and it's good, and it's true, but it's only so deep. So then the next level of love that I discovered, the second, is passionate. And passionate is very interesting because it's evolutionary, right? All animals are experiencing this. That there's this drive then passionately that's erotic, that's very lower chakra centric, that instigates the perpetuation of every species, that it's the gateway ultimately for deeper levels of love, passionate love, right? That then you get hooked on this individual, that you're exchanging then ideas and thoughts and experiences that get you vested in this other individual. And we've all experienced, right, passionate love. Then the third level is courageous. And courageous is very interesting because now all of a sudden there's this recognition that there's an other, right, in the relationship. There's me and this other person. And that with this other person, it's going to hurt. But it's going to be worth it because it's so good, right? That it's not the romantic love that I idolized. It's something different. And all the passion doesn't make it okay. But there's this other person. So I've got to be courageous enough now to love this person and know that it's going to hurt and be willing to go through that hurt. So then in the fourth stage that I discovered of love is selfless love. And now this is where it starts to get really interesting. That's this recognition that there's an us that's greater than both myself and the other. That there's an us, in other words, that transcends and includes both individuals. Just like Aristophanes talks about the two separates that become. Just like the protons and neutrons and electrons that come together to form an atom, or the atoms that form a cell. With selfless love, there is a clear recognition and a sense of identity of an us that is greater than just me. This is very interesting because then, at that point, when an individual, when we've entered selfless love, we're willing to sacrifice things that we wouldn't otherwise sacrifice, right? For our significant other, for children, for these things that are then greater than us, right? It makes us want to become better, want to become more for that entity, right? For that union, yeah? And you notice I use that word again, becoming, that really there's this story since the beginning of time that's then extrapolated through us, through the mechanism of love, of becoming more, that this thing wants to happen, right, through us. All right, and so then the fifth stage of love that I discovered is transcendent love. And Martin Buber talks about it in this I-thou relationship, right? And this is really fascinating because this is where it really starts to explode. That then we're loving the great other, the great mother, the great father through our significant other. That it becomes a mystical experience, a religious experience, if you will, that through the eyes of our other, we're giving love to love itself, right? That it becomes more even than just an us, that I am carrying on this practice, that I'm carrying this torch with my significant other of what it is to practice love, that I'm willing to die for this thing, if that is even the case, that it is so much bigger than not just me and not just the other, but bigger than us. That I am now, in fact, carrying the torch of the edges of consciousness for love itself, right? That I'm loving God, that I'm loving spirit, right? That I'm having this mystical experience through my expression of how I show up, right, with the significant other in my life. So through these five stages of love, romantic, passionate, courageous, selfless, and transcendent, right, during this 10-year study, I see these markers of evaluating intuition. That is increasing commitment and decreasing impulsivity. That through each stage, commitment grows and impulsivity decreases. That we still feel the pull of impulsivity, but the commitment is so strong because the will to become beyond myself, beyond an us, right, starts to increase on a molecular level, right? That love is indeed physically transforming us. You know, at each stage, as these things increase, fulfillment increases. And fulfillment is something that's very interesting because fulfillment is very different from happiness. But in Western culture, we think of those things as being symbiotic, but they're not. The fulfillment is really about responsibility. And the indicators really for depression, right, and loneliness and solitude and rage and anger are all related to the lack of responsibility. That the solution on a most core level in psychology to fulfillment is giving responsibility, right? That if a child feels, you know, distraught, you give the child a dog or a goldfish, that automatically they have a responsibility, right? Now they have to become more to take care of that dog or that goldfish, right? That fulfillment is a marker from responsibility, yeah, from commitment. So this is how the soul, right, when I talked about the body grows hair and the mind grows intuitions and the soul grows, the mind grows thoughts and the soul grows intuitions. This is how the soul wants to transform through us, right? Through the vehicle of our body, right? Of our senses, right? Of our experiences. That it speaks to our intuition to do that. Our role then is to surrender to that, right? And if I think about that term also just on a base molecular level, on your very worst day, on your very worst moment, maybe, if you wanted to just die, right? Or on your very best moment, one thing was happening. You were still growing your cells. You still grew all your skin. You still grew the marrow in your bones, right? On a very base level, you were always growing these things and you never thought once about it, right? And so in the same way, that is what surrender is. Surrender is not to give up. Surrender is to surrender to something greater, right, than yourself. Yeah. And that you've done that already by growing your own fingerprint, by growing your own cells. And it's to surrender then to that calling, that deep intuition that is subtle, right? This personal legend, this listening to your heart. But that by surrendering that, we allow love to transform us, right? We allow this miracle that will always be challenging, but that we always become more, right? I also think about this in terms of, because in Western culture, you know, and as I was exploring this, particularly in the first documentary film with this exploration of love, about purpose, yeah, and Western culture is very much about productivity, which is okay, which is beautiful. But the purpose of life itself is not productivity, right? It's really about play. It's really about becoming, right? It's really about, in other words, listening to that, that intuition, yeah, to become more. And we notice that we're becoming more because we have increasing depth and increasing sensitivity, increasing beauty. We start to recognize in very simple things as we're becoming. And you can feel it, right, in your body when you're following that thing, when you take a risk, when you say no to one thing and yes to something else, and you feel like, you know, I don't know why this is the right choice, but this is the right choice, right? You engage that. Who in here has felt that before? When you feel like everybody wants you to go do this thing, yes, almost everyone in here. Everybody wants you to go do this thing, but you know that you have to go do this thing, yeah? I just got off a plane at midnight last night coming from Hawaii, and I wanted to stay in Hawaii forever, and I had to cut my trip short, but I knew I needed to be here today because this is part, you know, driving this message and this study that has been 10 years and is continuing, right, is part of my own personal legend, that nothing is beyond that, that for me to show up in this world, I have to continue to become more, and so being here today is very much a part of that. I think about, also, the last thing I'll say about this is that following that feeling, right, it starts to permeate outward, yeah, and tying back into love transforming us into this feeling of the personal legend or of listening to our heart, right, and of listening to intuition, that there's also this brief moment, this instant, where we step beyond time. So we all know conceptually, right, that time doesn't really exist. It's just a functioning factor of evolution, yeah, that we perceive time. But that when we get lost, you know, like for instance, if you get lost in something and it seems like it's a couple minutes, but really you've been in it for hours, right? Who here has experienced that? Yeah, very much so. That's when you're really listening to your intuition, right? That's when you're getting lost in something, right? And that's then ultimately, as I indicate also in this film, in Grace and Grit, how we live forever. It's not by living longer, but it's by exiting the stream of time, by listening to our intuition, yeah? By following that above all. That is how love transforms us. Thank you. Yeah. Yes, the movie, it's the most popular movie and one of the most popular movies in Latin America. And in the U.S. it streams on Apple and Amazon. And in the credits, you'll see the actors next to the real people. And I chose that book particularly to adapt into a movie because these stages of love, these five stages, were so clearly depicted, yeah, in the book. And when I was finished with the book, I bawled my eyes out, right? And it was heart-wrenching. And yet I was full of hope. And I noticed the difference between the part of me that was heart-wrenched and heartbroken and the part of me that was full of hope. And the part of me that was heartbroken was the me here now, wanting to believe in romantic and passionate love forever. But the part of me that was full of love and full of hope was the part of me that was selfless and transcendent love. Yeah. And it's the same reason why people like Titanic. Titanic's not a downer, but it's a really sad film. And everybody knows at the end of the movie, right? Never let go, Jack, never let go, right? And this is the same thing in this movie, that cancer and illness is dealt with in this movie. But like Titanic is not about the sinking of a ship. It's just that the sinking of the ship is the vehicle by which these two individuals overcome their limitations and overcome themselves to say, hey, you know, we're going to be here together. We want to live beyond time somehow, right? And we're going to do that in this moment that I'd rather have this one robust moment that permeates on forever than live on in sort of a way that is, it has apathy in it. So I wanted to articulate that. So thank you for that. Also, you know, I think that the movie is very well received in America. It's like 98% on Amazon. But it's not super popular in the United States, whereas it's super popular in Latin America. We don't advertise it at all down there. And we were exploring why is that. And what we found out when we explored that is that American audiences in general like to see movies as escapism. They want to see movies that they forget, that a year later, they don't know what it's about. Whereas Latin audiences want to be stirred up by a movie. They want to see a movie that's going to make them cry, right? And laugh and engage, yeah? So I hope everyone in here will have the opportunity to see that movie. I think in the gift bags, there's a card about where to see that movie. We have time, I think, for another question or thought, please. What a beautiful question. What a beautiful statement. Yeah. You know, love is this dynamic, right? That has this long sense of humor. And I want to touch on that for a second and then come back to put a button on that, right? That when I think about God or spirit, there's this sort of sense of humor that's really long. In other words, right, that if you were God and you came into the world for like 50 years or 100 years, let's say, you would say, well, I want to feel this way. I want to do this. I want to do this. Now, if you had 10 lifetimes, you'd say, well, okay, maybe one lifetime I'll do this and another lifetime I'll do that. But if you had 1,000 lifetimes, you say, well, all right, well, maybe one time I'd like to be an emperor and one time I'd like to be a slave just because I want to feel it all. Well, if you had unlimited lifetimes, millions and billions and billions of lifetimes, at some juncture, you'd want to experience everything, right? And so there's this long sort of sense of humor that I think indicates the need, right, and demand for patience and openness within us. And I think your question and your statement about procuring love is very important because I think it's a lesson for each one of us every single day. And that is this, that I start really almost every day with a number of different practices and meditations. And I work on these in my office also in Santa Monica. But one of them is really about surrendering to. And Ramana Maharshi talks about the I, so the little I here and now. Right? And the big I, which is sort of identifying with spirit and sort of this transcendent self. And what I like to do, what I try to do, and I think that's what all religions also try to do on some level, is to surrender to this big I. And what that means is that I'll start with a very simple, let's say even a mantra, by saying anything is possible. So I might start my day by saying anything is possible. So let's say I'm having trouble in my relationship with my mother or my brother or my father or the sibling or the lover or whatever the thing is. And I say, you know what? I'm going to give this thing up, right? I'm going to surrender what I want out of this, and I'm going to totally surrender this and allow this to come in to my life however it wants to come in. Because ultimately, we limit what we're allowed to see, no matter who we are, no matter how we show up. I have a friend, and he's got no arms and no legs, right? And he's in this amazing relationship with this spectacular woman. And I'm like, how? Right? How? It's spectacular. I'm so in awe of him, right? But it's this patience and this surrender. And we notice, right, that no matter who we are, and no matter how we are, and what we show up with in the world, the relationship is not given to individuals because of some status or because of some thing. In other words, that at all levels, love is possible. Yeah. The most important requisite that we can achieve, right, to put a button on this, is to allow it in ways that we don't yet perceive it. In other words, that romantic love has a very specific visual that we think romantically, this is what I want, this is how it's going to be. But the moment I put that away, all of a sudden, hey, maybe it's a man that's going to love me. Maybe it's a woman that's going to love me. Maybe it's someone older than me. Maybe it's someone younger than me. Maybe it's someone totally different from me. Maybe it's someone that doesn't even look like me, that I don't identify with in any way whatsoever. And the moment we start to do that, all of a sudden, we allow this possibility. Does that make sense? But typical is a very interesting word, right? Because typical is also romantic, deals with expectations and paradigms. And whether it's this film that I made, right, or Titanic, right, is really that story about love that doesn't work, that because both people are fed up enough that they cross over that boundary of what's typical or supposed to be, to say, I'm going to love no matter what. I don't care what the circumstances are, right? So your job is just to surrender those ideas of what is coming and say, you know what, it's going to come no matter what, and I allow it in. Yeah, does that make sense? Well, yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Yes, thank you guys so much. Then.
Hey, thank you.